This is a copyrighted work. Unauthorized copying or distribution is a crime punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Scholastic Audio presents The Ghosts We Keep by Mason Deaver, read by Ian Alexander. I want you to be the very best version of yourself that you can be. Marion McPherson. From the movie Lady Bird, written and directed by Greta Gerwig. Wednesday, July 3rd, 2019. After. The summer after my brother was killed, my parents made me get a job at a frozen yogurt shop. It wasn't that hard to learn how to work things. The hard part was dealing with the customers. Put too few sprinkles on, they complained you were ripping them off. Give them too many, though, and they complained you were only making the froyo heavier to up the price when it was weighed. Nobody, it seemed, felt they ever had just the right amount of sprinkles. The shop was downtown, right near the heart of Kinston, and it also happened to be one of the hottest summers on record, so we were never not busy. Sometimes the shop would stay open until 11, which Mom wasn't in love with. I didn't mind the job, truly. The uniform was fine. My coworkers were mostly cool. I liked Julie, who usually shared my shifts. But she was balanced out by one of the managers, Henry, who took frozen yogurt way too seriously. I, however, did not take frozen yogurt seriously at all. The job did what it was meant to do, though. It got me out of the house, and it made me stop thinking about Ethan. Except when it didn't. Mom would pick me up after my shift ended. Tonight, she'd been waiting in the parking lot for the last 20 minutes, reading her book. "Bye, Liam," Julie waved to me as she walked to her car. I waved back. "How was your day?" Mom asked me as soon as I got in the car and buckled my seatbelt. This question always arrived like clockwork. She tried to hide the book by throwing it in the back seat, but I knew it was one of those grief counseling books. "Busy," I told her, handing over a cup of yogurt. We got a free cup once a shift. I always went with basic vanilla, some hot fudge, and those crispy rice M&Ms. Exactly what Ethan ordered every time we came here. "Oh yeah?" Mom took a spoonful. She eats the free cups for me because I got tired of eating them 2 weeks into the job. "That means good tips, though." "Not always, but tonight was good, $30. "Well, look at that." Mom put the car into reverse and backed out of her spot, frozen yogurt in the cup holder. The drive home was mostly quiet, just the voice of the weatherman talking about a storm coming up this weekend. May showers, apparently stretching into the first weeks of July. Things weren't always this quiet with us. They were getting a little better after our family therapy appointments, but we still hadn't eased back into a routine. Or at least, it didn't feel like we had. Mom didn't really like music anymore. She and Dad used to always have it on, dancing while they cooked, her feet bouncing while she read, his fingers tapping the wheel of the car while we drove. Now it was the weather, on loop. When we got home, I walked to my bedroom, throwing my froyo mandatory hat to the back of my closet. I knew that I should shower. I smelled like a cow that had been bathed in vanilla. I should have showered, but now that I was lying in bed, I didn't want to move. My feet hurt, and my hands still felt cold. I stretched my fingers in and out, trying to get some of the blood flowing through them again. Then I found my phone. For a moment, I considered texting Joel or Vanessa, telling them how my day had gone. It was muscle memory. I rolled out of bed, fidgeting to get my shirt off because all of a sudden, the clothes that I was wearing felt too heavy. Even underneath, my skin felt like it was crawling, like it was pressed too tight against my muscles, and no matter how I moved my body, everything was too close together. I wanted to crawl away, to scratch until I didn't feel the itch anymore. There was a knocking on my door. "Dad."
"Hey, we're going to bed."
"Night." I threw my shirt toward the hamper in my open closet. I didn't work the next day, so I'd have time to wash it.
Hopefully, it'd get the vanilla stench out.
I moved out of bed and walked down the hallway to the bathroom, setting the water on the hottest temperature it'd go before I turned on some music and stood in the shower for a bit.
Then I took a washcloth and tried to wash the scent of vanilla off my skin. The body wash smelled like coconut, and I debated whether or not that was an improvement as I bounced to the beat of the song, humming along to the mess of synths. I was surprised Mom or Dad didn't knock on the door, telling me to turn down the noise. I sniffed my wrist and smelled more coconut than vanilla, so I figured that I was clean enough. Also, I just wanted to go to sleep. I walked slowly back down the hallway, staring at the door to Ethan's room. Mom and Dad hadn't been in there for a while. They'd begun their summer cleaning out bits and pieces, washing some of the leftover clothes and donating them to Goodwill, but everything else had remained untouched. Or at least that's what they'd thought. There were other things missing now, things they'd never known existed. Back in my room, I turned off the lamp on my nightstand and crawled between my sheets. Every time I closed my eyes, I thought about the yogurt shop. I still smelled the vanilla. I probably should have been thinking about more important things, like how I was going to get into a good college when I started submitting applications this fall. With everything that had happened, my junior year had fallen apart toward the end. My summer had started with a month of classes. I'd failed. The sympathy my teachers felt for me only went so far. Come August, I'd be joining my classmates in our senior year, but all my do-over cards had been forfeited. I was angry with how school had made me handle the entire situation, and even angrier with myself for almost letting everything slip away. Or perhaps I should have been worried about how I didn't have my oldest friends anymore, and that I didn't know how to get them back. Or I should have been worried about Mom and Dad. I remembered reading somewhere that 75% of marriages end after the death of a child. But instead of all that, I wanted to worry about the frozen yogurt shop. I wanted to worry about getting my work done before I clocked out, making sure that I got the floors mopped. I wanted to stress out about whether I'd remembered to lay out the toppings for the morning crew. I wanted to be worried about pushing the pumpkin spice flavor because, for some reason, a dumbass executive had decided that the prime time to sell pumpkin spice flavored froyo was July. I was trying to fool myself. And if the last few months had taught me anything, it was that I was incredibly good at fooling myself. The truth would always find me. No matter how hard I pushed down its ugly head, it would find a way back in. Always. And it didn't smell like vanilla. I still found it so much easier to discuss frozen yogurt instead of my dead brother. Monday, March 25th, 2019. After. Ethan died on a Sunday. The coroner's office told us he was killed between 7:30 p.m. and 7:45 p.m. They couldn't give an exact time. I was up until 4 that night, or morning, I guess. Mom and Dad begged me to go to bed, told me to get some rest. They'd already started planning the funeral. I wanted to shout at them, ask them how they could already be picking out a casket when Ethan's body was only a few miles away at the hospital, barely cold, alone. I wanted to be there with him, just so he'd have someone. He didn't need anyone anymore, though. My bed was warm, the street now empty where hours ago it had been lined with cars. All the people who had showed up and started to clean our home for us barely an hour after Ethan died. Consoling Mom and Dad, vacuuming the carpet, dusting the tables, cleaning out the refrigerator of expired food, and bringing their own new food. To this day, I'm still not sure if it's just a Southern thing to take over a family's house when someone dies, or if people everywhere do that. I blinked, and when I opened my eyes again, it was 9. I felt awful. Worse than that time Vanessa and I had stolen some of her dad's whiskey when I was sleeping over. We had wanted to be adults like in the movie we were watching. I threw up that night, and my stomach hurt, and everything felt fuzzy when I woke up the next morning. Except this time, there was no fuzziness. There was no confusion. I knew exactly what had happened. It was an image burned into the backs of my eyelids any time I dared to close them. Vanessa. I rolled over, grabbing my phone and sending a quick text to her, asking her if she could come over. Then I just lay there. The house was empty once more, as if its very foundation was in mourning. It was quiet, until I heard the sound of the lawnmower in the backyard. For a moment, I had hope. Mowing the lawn was Ethan's job. Dad and I were both allergic to grass, so the moment that Ethan could sit in the lawnmower seat and reach the brakes, it was his responsibility. Dad paid him $30 every time he did it. That was how he'd saved up for his PS4. I found Mom on the patio, the awning protecting her from the morning sun. "Good morning," I said, climbing onto the chair next to her. "Morning," she said, taking a hit off her cigarette. Mom only smoked when she was stressed out, either from school or the heavy hours at work that she had to balance. This was the first time she'd done it in front of me, as if she wasn't ashamed anymore. I didn't even think she knew that I knew she smoked. I almost asked her if I could have one, but I wasn't in the mood for an ass-kicking. Collecting the ash was that infernal notepad, the yellow paper detailing all the events of the coming week. "I called your school this morning, told them you'd be absent for a while." Right, school. I wanted to ask how long "a while" meant, but I had a feeling not even Mom knew the answer to that. I hadn't been woken up by an alarm this morning. I hadn't needed to race to beat Ethan to the shower so I'd have a few precious ounces of hot water. I hadn't been forced to do anything but lie there, staring at the ugly popcorn detailing that dotted my ceiling, counting the seconds until I had to get up because it was physically hurting to lie there. I hadn't thought yet about how Ethan dying might disrupt the routine. I was thinking about it now. "The whole week?" I asked. Mom nodded. "We've settled on the funeral being Wednesday." "Okay. You'll need to get your suit refitted," she told me. "It barely fit when Barney died, and you've grown since then." Barney had been Nana's boyfriend? Husband? You think someone in their 80s would feel like dating was a thing they shouldn't be doing anymore, and I never would have called their relationship romantic. More like parasitic. He lived in her house, slept in her bed. They were close on some level, but Nana hadn't even cried for him when he died. That had been the last funeral we'd had to go to. "Mom, we bought that suit when I was 14, I reminded her. "It won't fit me again, no matter how much it's hemmed." "Right," she took a moment to think. "I'll just give you my card and you can go buy another one." I watched as she took out another cigarette and lit it before speaking again. "Your Aunt Donna is coming over." "I think Vanessa's coming over too," I said. The night before, as we'd stepped out of Vanessa's car, she'd grabbed me as I fell to the ground. She held me, listened to me cry, rubbed my back, demanded that I squeeze her hand so she knew I could hear her, and attempted to get me to calm my breathing when she thought I was hyperventilating.
"Maybe you two can go ahead and get your suit, get you both out of the house."
"Maybe," I said. She'd have to drive. I didn't have my license. "Where's Dad?" I asked, watching as the lawnmower drove by slowly. It was Mr. Dixon, from across the street. He was on his own lawnmower, too, not our new bright orange one.
"He had to go down to the hospital for something."
"What?"
"I don't know."
Mom sounded agitated.
"He just had to go. They called him down there."
"But why?"
"I don't know, Liam. They just wanted one of us down there, and I couldn't..."
She leaned back in her seat.
"I couldn't bring myself to go."
"Okay. Sorry." Mom didn't say anything. She let me walk back into the house and up to my room with a sick feeling in my stomach. It didn't feel real, even though I'd watched from the side of the road as Ethan was loaded into the ambulance. I looked at my phone and the first thing I saw was my text to Joel still there, labeled red, but with no reply. I guess he had no idea what to do when his best friend texted to say that his older brother was dead. Vanessa had replied, though. "Vanessa, on my way," heart emoji. After sitting at my desk for 20 minutes, scrolling through all the new in memoriam Instagram posts Ethan had been tagged in by his classmates, I got into the shower, just barely bothering to wash my hair and let the water run down my arms and off the tips of my fingers. I couldn't even properly clean myself. I just didn't have the energy. I couldn't believe it. I didn't want to believe it. And yet, the universe didn't care what I wanted. It had taken Ethan without a trace of guilt or sorrow, without any pity for what I might feel afterward. I felt it then, the absence of my brother, and I knew that I'd feel it for the rest of my life. In digging for clothes to wear before Vanessa arrived, I found the shirt that I'd been wearing the night before. It was a white shirt, with the words, "Today is going to be a great day, and here's why," from Dear Evan Hansen. I'd gotten it the previous year for Christmas, along with a vinyl of the Broadway show that I never dared to actually play because I didn't want it to get warped or worn. It was one of my favorite shirts, except now with new dried red-brown stains, it made me sick to look at, so I balled it up and threw it as far back into my closet as it could go. Vanessa ambled up the stairs a few moments later, and we just stared at each other as she leaned in my doorframe. "Hey," she finally said. I stared at her brown skin, the dark circles under her eyes, her curled black hair a little messy, the oversized flannel shirt she wore over her favorite Paramore shirt. "Hey, how'd you sleep?" she asked. "Barely," I told her. "You should get some rest," she said. "Yeah," that was all I could muster. She sat down at my desk, pressing her fingers on the keys of my keyboard that sat unplugged so no noise came out. We'd known each other since preschool. She was the first person I'd met on my first day, and she'd joined my protests whenever I demanded the teacher finish reading Where the Wild Things Are during story time. We'd never not been best friends, but at that moment, I had no idea how to talk to her. My
mom wants. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.